What's up, everybody, and welcome to another video. In today's video, we're going to be talking all about, what are we talking about again in today's video? How to make a TV mount? I don't know. Is that interesting enough? Okay, you know what? I think I got it. In today's video, we're going to talk about why and how you can get started in welding. Because I think that every builder and maker out there needs to know how to weld. Because when you know how to weld, you unlock a whole new world of building possibilities. Things that you can never hope to make in wood are a walk in the park when you're working with metal. You can make things that are super strong and also super compact. And then when you start mixing wood and steel together, you can make some really interesting stuff. So today I'm going to walk you through the basics of everything that you will need to start welding. But first, let me show you what we're gonna be making. I bought this big giant TV to use as a monitor for video editing, and it's fantastic. All that screen real estate really helps, and also it's an OLED, so it just looks fantastic, but it's a TV. And as a result, it has this big giant stand on it, as well as this big butt that hangs out the backside. So it just takes up way more space than it needs to. So what I would like to do in today's video is create a bracket that I attach to the back of my desk that I can then mount the TV on. It'll be sleek, compact, I'll integrate some cable management into it, maybe even a spot to mount my microphone, and then when it's all said and done, I should regain about 3 square feet of desk real estate. I also happen to think that this is a pretty perfect example of why you would want to learn to weld, because to make something like this in any material other than metal would be a complete pain. Quick note before we head to the shop, a portion of this video is sponsored by RZ Masks, but we'll talk more about that once we get to a point in the video where I can actually use their product. With that out of the way, let's head to the shop. Now that we are here in the shop, we're gonna get started with some of the basics. I think the first thing that we gotta point out is that today, I'm going to be working with a MIG welder. I think for DIY enthusiasts and furniture makers, a MIG welder is probably your best bet. They're relatively inexpensive and simple to operate. There's also TIG welders for more precision work and then stick welders for heavier duty jobs. But if you're just starting out, I think a MIG welder is the way to go. This right here is the Miller-Matic 211, and it's the welder that I've been using for the past couple of years. It runs on single phase 120 volt circuits, so you can plug it into basically any household outlet and it should run just fine, at least for lighter gauge steel. Heavier stuff requires a little bit more juice, and then you might need to switch over to a 220 volt circuit. But when you're first starting out, honestly, 120 volts should be plenty to get you going. Coming off of the welder, you have 3 main leads. First one is the power. I think you're all pretty familiar with this one. You just plug it into the wall. The second one, this one's a little bit more complicated. This is your ground clamp, and you either clamp it directly to your work surface, or if your work surface isn't conductive, you attach it directly to the metal you're working on. And then this one right here is the business end. So if you pull this trigger, 3 things happen. First, an electrical circuit is activated and voltage is supplied to the tip. 2, a conductive wire is fed out of the welder and out through the tip. And 3, shielding gas is released through the tip as well. Technically, that last step is optional. You don't need to use shielding gas, but I highly recommend it. It will make your welds a lot cleaner and your job a lot easier. And by the way, you can get the tank and the shielding gas at any welding supply store. So to put all that together, here's how it all works. You get 2 pieces of metal, you butt them together, you put the tip of the welder on their seam, pull the trigger, and the conductive wire is fed into that seam. It heats up to a ridiculous temperature, melting itself and a little bit of metal on each side of the seam, fusing everything together. And the shielding gas is there keeping any oxygen away, which keeps anything else from reacting. It's actually surprisingly simple and easy to do. And what I mean by that is it's easy to do a crappy but functional job. Doing nice clean work, that takes a lot of practice and skill. But hey, today we're just building a TV stand, so we're not shooting for perfection here. So that's the basics of the welding setup. Now, before we do any actual welding, we need to cut a little bit of metal. And before we do that, we had to put on some safety equipment, which brings us nicely back around to today's sponsor, RZ Mask. Just like when you're working with any material, when you're cutting metal, you're releasing dust and other contaminants into the air. So a good high quality mask is important to keep you from breathing any of that in. Come to think of it, I bet you it's worse to breathe metal dust than it is to breathe wood dust. But either way, I wear my RZ mask for both. For me personally, these masks have three main selling points. They're easy to put on with a single strap, so you never have to slow down your workflow. They're comfortable, so I don't mind wearing them all day. And they have replaceable filters that filter up to 99% of airborne particles. So you can reuse them and you aren't constantly throwing out disposable masks. And I also happen to think they look pretty cool, but that's not nearly as important as the first three points. In addition to the mask, you're also gonna want some safety glasses and some gloves. Now that we got our safety gear sorted, let's go cut some metal. If you wanna weld metal together, you're probably also going to need a way to cut it. Personally, I've found that this cold cut metal chop saw is the best way to do simple cuts, but you could also use a bandsaw or even an angle grinder in a pinch. Now, as much as I'd love to hop right into welding this metal, there are a couple of things we're gonna have to do first. One, you gotta clean your metal with some mineral spirits. Most steel will come coated in some sort of oil to keep it from corroding. If you don't strip that off before welding, you're going to end up breathing it in as smoke while you weld. And two, you should apply a slight bevel to the seams of your metal where you're gonna be joining any pieces together. We'll talk more about this later, but this will give you a stronger weld and make your life easier. With all our metal cut, we can now head over to our welding workstation, because where you weld is also pretty important too. Ideally, it will be some sort of flat, non-combustible, and conductive surface. Non-combustible because you are going to be dealing with some crazy high temperatures, and if you're welding on a wooden bench, well, you might just cause it to catch fire. Don't ask me how I know that. Generally speaking, the less flammable stuff you have around your welding surface, the better. And then conductive because, like I was saying before, you need somewhere to put this ground clamp. If your whole surface is conductive, well, then you can just put it somewhere out of the way. I actually made this welding table. At this point, it's been through a few different iterations, but I'll include a link in the video description to the video where I originally made this table, just so you can get some insight into the thought process behind the design of it. Okay, just give me like 30 more seconds. I want to talk about one more thing, and then we can actually start welding. You are going to need three very important pieces of safety equipment before you start welding. A helmet to protect your eyes from the bright light from the welding bead and to keep your face free from any sparks. A welding jacket to protect your torso from the intense heat coming off the weld and any sparks as well. And then a pair of gloves to keep your hands safe. Now please, I am zooming in for emphasis here. Please do not skimp on any of these three pieces of equipment. You are dealing with some crazy temperatures when you're welding, and I would hate to see one of you get burned just because you tried to save a few bucks when you were buying your welding gloves. Okay, we are now at the point of the video that we have all been waiting for, myself included. We are actually gonna start welding. And the first thing we're gonna do is set up our welder. On the front of the machine, there are two settings that you wanna play with. First is voltage, which you adjust based on the thickness of the steel you're working with. So in my case, I'm working with 3/16 steel, so I'm gonna adjust this knob to between 7 and 8 here. And then the other one up top is the wire speed, which adjusts the speed at which the wire comes out of the tip of the welder. As you gain experience, you're probably gonna play with these settings quite a bit depending on what you're doing. But when you first start out, I would stick to the recommended voltage based on the label on your machine, and then I would keep the wire speed rate kind of on the low side. Then get on your protective gear and get ready to start welding. Now, if this is actually your first time welding, I would highly suggest you get some scrap metal and practice on that before doing any mission critical work. The process that has always worked the best for me is to start by lightly tacking the seams together in two places. I then check to make sure that everything is square and how I want it. And then if it isn't, I simply break the tack by flexing the seam and trying it all again. Once I'm satisfied with that initial tack, I then set about fully welding the seam together. This is done by starting at one end of the seam and then slowly moving the welder to the other side while making small circular motions that look like this. There's a lot of debate about pushing the welding tip versus pulling the welding tip. I kind of like pushing a bit better, but honestly, when you're first getting started, just do what works best for you. You can worry about finessing it once you get a little bit more experience. If you do all of that, you should have a fully welded together seam that looks a little something like this. When I'm actually working, I won't tack and then weld each individual seam. What I'll usually do is tack together the whole shape that I'm working on, and then as a last step, I'll go around and fully weld together all of the seams. All right, I think that's enough practice. Let's move on to building this actual monitor mount, and while I do that, I'll give you a couple more tips.
After you got the welder, a decent workbench, and all of your safety gear sorted, the first thing I would start to look at is some magnetic welding blocks. If you get the good ones, they'll pull double duty. They'll keep your steel firmly locked in place, which is important because when you're welding, there's so much heat involved that it can often cause your pieces to shift and move around. In fact, if you don't have a magnetic block, make sure you clamp your metal in place before welding. And then second, they'll double as squares and angle gauges. The square ones are perfect 90s, and then there's big ones like this that you can set to any angle. If you use good, high-quality blocks, it basically removes the need to check your work at every step. Also, if whatever you're working on is structurally important, it's probably a good idea to weld both sides of the seams. It allows the weld to penetrate deeper into the steel, which makes your weld that much stronger.
Nice. This is now starting to look like a genuine TV stand. So let me show you a couple of things I did here. You have the two main pillars, this one and this one. I'm gonna drill some holes in this, and that's where the TV is gonna mount. Then up top here, I have this block. I'm gonna drill a hole through the top, and that's where I'm gonna mount my microphone. And then down here at the bottom, I have these two little loops for cable management. Now comes the part in the process where if you're bad at welding, you're probably gonna spend the majority of your time. We're gonna take the stand outside, and we are going to grind down all the welds until they look nice.
When you're first learning to weld, chances are you're gonna do some really ugly work, but the nice thing about welding is that the only difference between an ugly weld and a nice weld is a little bit, or a lot of bit, of grinding. Just toss a flap disc on your angle grinder and go to town. And as you can see, while doing the grinding, I also put on my RZ mask to keep my lungs safe from all those little metal bits. If you'd like to get your own RZ mask, they've actually arranged a discount code for my viewers. Just enter ZachBuilds20 at checkout and you'll get 20% off your entire order. I'll include a link in the video description directly to their store.
Okay, that wasn't too bad. Seeing as this is just a TV stand and I'm never actually gonna really see it, I didn't see the point investing that much time into making it all perfect, but if this were something like a table base, I would spend hours out there grinding it until everything was perfect. At this point, we are very close to being done, but we got two little jobs left to do. First of which is drilling a bunch of holes in this thing for all the mounting points.
The nice thing about TVs and monitors is that they use a standard mounting pattern. So in the future, if I ever decide to change my screen, I should be able to just reuse the same mounting holes. And if not, well, it's not that big of a deal to drill some new holes either. Once I was done with the holes for the screen, I drilled some along the back to screw into the desk, and then I added one more big one up top for my microphone arm.
And now we'll throw a couple quick coats of paint on it.
For this build, I went with some simple satin black spray paint that I had left over from my hammock frame build. Normally, I wouldn't spray right onto bare steel like this, but this is a paint and primer in one, and so far, it's been holding up really well on my hammock frame that's outside, so I figured it wouldn't be an issue for this indoor TV stand.
Now that this guy's all painted, we can take him home and get it installed. Although, I might actually wait till tomorrow because it got quite late out. I don't know where the day went. But for you guys at home, it'll seem like no time at all. Gotta love that movie magic, right? Okay, now for the fun part. We actually get to install this thing, but I think the first thing we should do is pull this desk off the wall and create a little bit more room to work, and then also maybe take some stuff off it and clean it up a little bit. Movie magic. Now, one thing that I really regret about this desk is making it so heavy. Don't get me wrong, I love it, but it is way too heavy. Now, if I did everything right, this bracket should just slide right over this like slow. Oh, it's a little bit tight, but that's okay. I think that'll go on there. It's good. Take a little bit of persuasion. I really wish I had a wood block right now to tap this in with, but this little towel is gonna have to do. It's all I have. Almost don't even need to screw it. It's gonna be in there so tight. Oh, okay, it's on. In retrospect, definitely should have made that a little bit looser. And now we screw it in.
Given how tight that bracket was, these screws might be a little bit unnecessary, but then again, I am mounting a big TV to it, so better safe than sorry.
And right about now is when I wish I had a full-time assistant to help me out with installs, because this is gonna get a little bit awkward, lifting this and screwing it to the mount.
Normally, there is no way that I would do this with a power tool, but seeing as this cordless screwdriver is so low torque, I wasn't really worried about it cross-threading or over-tightening these bolts. This thing is really handy, by the way.
And just like that, we are done. Let's see how this thing looks from the front. Oh man, what a difference that makes. Let's go over some of these improvements real quick. The whole screen has been recessed about 6 inches, which A, I think will help with ergonomics because it'll mean more of the screen is in my field of vision all at the same time. And B, I've gained a metric boatload of desk space. I know 6 inches doesn't seem like a lot, but as a reference, here's the original stand. So you can see this thing took up quite a bit of space. I now also have a much better spot to mount my microphone. When I want to use it, I can bring it down to my face and get it a lot closer. And then when I'm not using it, I can actually kind of tuck it away behind the screen so that it doesn't look as cluttered. And as a final cherry on top, around back, all of my cables are a little bit better managed too. All of these things I consider to be huge wins. And frankly speaking, if I wasn't trying to make this project into a YouTube video, I could have whipped up something like this and had it painted inside of 3 hours. And that's the magic of knowing how to weld and the reason that I think that every builder and maker should know how to do it. I've talked to a lot of people about this and there seems to be this perception out there that welding is an extremely hard skill to learn. And I get it. There's science happening, there's crazy high temperatures, there's extreme voltages. It can be intimidating and you definitely need to be cautious. But at the same time, it isn't some mystical skill that's above most makers learning. Being a great welder who can stack dimes all day, that's tough. That takes years of practice. But being a hobbyist who can make a TV stand or a table base in their garage, that's the type of thing that most people can learn in a couple days. And I think I'm a great example of this. I am far from the world's greatest welder. I mean, this TV stand is probably like my 10th welding project at most, but I can zap together functional stuff and then grind it until it looks decent. And for me, that's enough to open up a whole new world of possibilities. And on that note, that seems like a good a spot as any to end this video. So thank you so much for watching. If you would like to support this channel, the absolute best thing you can do is like, comment, and subscribe if you aren't already. I would really appreciate it, and it all helps the channel to grow. Big thank you to RZ Masks for sponsoring a portion of this video, and an especially big thank you to all my Patreon supporters. I really think we're starting to develop a fun community over there, and I'm really enjoying it. And actually, I recently asked everybody over there if they would like to have their names added to the end of these videos, and the consensus seemed to be yes. So, thank you very much to these special people. That's it for me, and I will see you in the next video. Peace.
Don't say RZ mask. Don't say RZ mask. Don't say RZ mask. Don't say RZ mask. It's RZ mask. It's RZ mask.
Okay, before we head to the shop today, I should let you know that a portion of today's video is sponsored by RZ. Damn it.